Hey, what's going on, gamers? Welcome back to another episode of Damage Meter. My name is Matt Jarbo. I'm your host. I come from TwistedJoystick.com, although by now you should know that it's an awesome site full of daily news, games, stuff, video games, information, and everything of the like. So, hope you guys check that one out. I'm going to get right into it this week. There's a lot to cover. First off, I'd like to say From Dust is amazing, as is Bastion. The Summer of Arcade so far is fantastic. I'm looking forward to Insanely Twisted Shadow Planet and the toy battle one, like whose name I can't remember right now. Fruit Ninja Connect, meh. But you know, hey, I don't have a Connect, so I don't think I'm gonna plunk down the $10 for it. But I do want that Crimson Alliance, so that's a tough call. Anyway, let's get on with it. So in this week in gaming, Diablo 3 has been a quite a big topic of conversation. So they're saying now that Diablo 3 is gonna have to be online to play. You know, so it's not going to be able to take that with you offline, which I can see kind of why they're doing that, but it's one of those situations where gamers are freaking out over it because they like being able to play Diablo 2 offline and online. And really, the DRMs on this case is just, it's ridiculous. I get piracy. I get it. I understand that people, like companies out there, the developers out there want to protect their intellectual properties. I understand that completely. But DRMs really are just bad for the industry because you're forcing players to take part in something that they may not be able to get out of their control. Like, let's say someone's internet goes down. It happens. Do you have Time Warner Cable? All the fucking time, right? All the time my internet goes out, right? And so if I had a DRM, I couldn't play. I could not play games like that. And certain video games are doing that too on consoles. And so it's like, no, it's ridiculous, because if the internet goes out, we have to be able to play our games in the meantime. Because I think that if you limit it, then you're only going to be hurting gamers in general. Let's see here. No offline mode, says Blizzard. It's going to have a persistent friends list, cross-game chat via real ID system, persistent characters that are stored server-side, meaning no more having to play online once every 90 days, nor item duplication cheats, persistent party system, player versus player and public game matchmaking, dynamic drop-in, drop-out for co-op, larger item stash that gets shared amongst your characters, at the moment up to 10, the auction house, which will be discussed here in a second, and the achievement system and detailed stat tracking for both of which feed into the final point. I mean, like, really, though? I can understand, but this isn't a fucking MMO, Blizzard. You need to get off the World of Warcraft kick. This is a singular experience. It has co-op, but it's you know, Diablo is a singular experience. So there's no need to have all these things on there, right? If people want to cheat, let them cheat. They want to, you know, if they try to, like, and this is going to, you know, and I'm saying, I think the reason why all this is coming into play, if you want my honest-to-God opinion, it's going to be because of the auction house that they're creating, right? The fact that you can sell in-game items for real-world cash while Blizzard gets a cut. So basically, at that point, they're opening up an auction house where they're going to see, you know, infinite profits that are going to be coming in from people buying, you know, buying goods through this service. So it's, you know, I mean, granted, yeah, it's to take away people selling items on, like, you know, eBay and shit, which is still going to happen. People don't want to pay a cost for that. Or, you know, scamming and that kind of stuff. But I think that's the key right there. They're online. They're constantly online, so they can monitor all this stuff. This is stuff they learned from World of Warcraft. I honestly feel that this is, I don't know, I've lost all interest in Diablo 3 at this point now. Because, quite frankly, I really don't care about an auction house. I'm not going to sell stuff on there, because selling digital shit like that kind of bothers me a little bit. But people will make money at it. Gold farmers are going to be able to farm gold now and sell it without having to do, you know, back alley channels, I guess. It's going to be interesting, but I honestly feel that this is going to hurt Blizzard, and I really hope that you gamers out there that are upset about this don't just bitch about it and then buy the game anyway. Bitch about it, don't buy the game, and show them with your wallet. There you go. There is that. Now, moving on, Battlefield 3 is also going to have the same kind of thing that Homefront did, Mortal Kombat did, a bunch of these games have done. They're going to have the online pass to play if you get the game secondhand. Now, I don't know. I think I've made my complaints about this before in the past. I get why they do it. I understand they want to get away from the, you know, from the used game market and shit, because they'll have that. But, like, I don't know. I mean, they're not calling it the online pass, but their system is going to have it, and it's going to, I think, affect them. Certain games, you know, like a game like Battlefield, people buy right off the bat, so it's hard to get late adopters into it because people will get it and everything. And then if you sell them someone a used copy and they have to go spend another $15, $20 to go get the online pass, whatever they're going to charge, then I think that they're really going to there it's just going to kind of hurt the thing as it is, because I mean it's just it's ridiculous ultimately. So that's what they're saying. Battlefield 3 will have an online pass. Square Enix acquires the rights to True Crime Hong Kong. Oh dear God, why? True Crime was a bad enough series. I mean, True Crime Streets of LA was kind of fun. I used to, you know, drive around LA and, you know, like try to get to where I, you know, where I remembered from LA and driving around and stuff. I never played Streets of New York. And I think the reason why I never played True Crime New York was because the in True Crime Streets of LA, there was like the three branching paths, but on the last true path is where you encountered the Chinese zombies and the flaming skulls and the fiery breathing dragon, which was part of the true story of the game. Like the so I don't understand that. So because of that, I'm kind of not going to check that one out. But I mean, Square has been purchasing a lot of games recently, publishing a lot more because of the financial troubles that they're in. So we'll see what happens with this. I'm just glad Activision isn't doing it. So maybe. I don't know. I'll wait for screenshots and I'll wait for a demo and hopefully it will get me going. Yeah, yeah, I really want this. It's going to be awesome. Oh, yeah. I don't know. Probably not. But here's something cool. Official PlayStation Magazine is claiming that TimeSplitters 4 is going to be announced very, very soon, which is great because TimeSplitters 1 and 2 were awesome. TimeSplitters 3 was a little bit weird because I believe it was... I believe it was Free Radical's first multi-platform title, not to mention they were doing the multiplayer, designing your own levels and uploading those. And at the time, that was kind of an untested format on the system, especially over Xbox Live on a, you know, on an 8-gig model and everything. So we'll see what happens with that. But I really like TimeSplitters. I think it's a really great arcade, over-the-top, first-person shooter with insane multiplayer, and it's a lot of fun. And those guys are always... fantastic. I just hope, well, I don't remember who Free Radical turned into. They did something else. Actually, I'm sorry, going back, looking at this, Crytek actually was the guys who developed the game originally. They were Free Radical, then I think EA got them, and then they moved into Crytek. So, Crysis, that's awesome. And they've openly confirmed that they're interested in reigniting the series. Hopefully, we'll see an E3 announcement next year. You never know. So, a little rumor coming up. That's going to be a lot of fun. All right, so I guess an interesting thing that John Carmack said is against the shooting in Oslo, which is horrible. I don't know if you guys have been following that, but the shooting in Oslo has, like, because of the guy who did the shooting was an avid gamer, and people think, oh, he's a gamer, this must mean violent video games will make people kill people, you know. And of course, we've seen this before with the guys from freaking Columbine playing 14,000 hours of Doom. And we've seen this before in other tragedies where people play video games and they think, oh, no, it's this horrible, horrible thing. But, you know, John Carmack from id Software, the creator of Doom, has said that, no, really, it reduces aggression rather than increases aggression. And I completely have to agree with that, because when you play a game, you know, you are acting out whatever impulse you have. So... you know, going through and then just blowing a lot of shit up is going to allow you to get that aggression out. There are places in real world places where you can go and pay money and just break shit. And that's kind of what video games allow you to do. You get that same sensation without the physical action of it. So anyone who says that video games cause violence, I have to wholeheartedly disagree with. I believe that video games do reduce violence. It's upbringing of parents and not explaining to children the difference between reality and fantasy. I do believe that's a key thing too. Showing your child something like Kill Bill and saying, oh my God, that's awesome, I'd love to be able to do that, will cause your child to then go, oh, maybe I can do that. You know, whereas I think with video games, it's all about the monitoring of, you know, if you teach your child that it is something that is meant as a relaxation tool, as a stress relieving tool versus a training simulator, you might have a better opportunity of allowing them to fully comprehend the idea behind gaming and not, you know, let people, i.e. the Christian right, say, well, this stuff is bad for you. So I completely agree with Carmack here that games definitely reduce aggression, and I really hope that that we're able to move past the Oslo incident and not see a huge hit for gaming over there in Europe, because that's kind of what they're pushing. You know, it sucks because Australia just overturned the ban on 18 plus games. And now Oslo gets hit, and they're removing those kind of games from store shelves. So it's like one victory and then one setback, and it's horrible all the way around. So that about wraps up this week on Damage Meter. Just for final thoughts, I'd like to, my thoughts and prayers do go out to the families of the victims in Oslo. It was a horrible crime. It was a horrible thing. And you know, a lot of us out there are very, very, very sorry for your loss, and we do not wish any ill harm on anyone else. Thank you for listening. I will see you guys next Monday. Have a great week. Enjoy gaming. Check out Summer of Arcade. It's fantastic. All right. Have a good one.